So as I said, the institute is arranging a orientation program on 20th, and therefore some of the discussions, particularly regarding TA duties in general and so on, I've been asked to speak there to all the 1,000 people. So that portion, which ordinarily I would have started with, I'm postponing to 20th. And today and on Monday, we shall have purely technical discussions and orientation in the lab. Our environment is almost entirely Unix, except for the administrative support staff, which likes to use Microsoft Word and Excel and so on. They use it, and therefore some of us have to maintain a dual identity. So I have, for example, a few machines which run purely Ubuntu or Linux, some machines which run purely Microsoft, and some are dual boot machines. But the lab environment that you will be working with, and particularly the lab environment which the BTech students will be working with, for whom you will be TAs, that is almost entirely Linux. So familiarity with Unix is the first objective. Some of you who have worked extensively with Unix might find this a little repetitive, but it's worthwhile, because what I have understood in last almost 30 years of my brush with Unix is that however extensively you have used Unix, there are still n number of things which you still do not know. So if it is true with me, it's most likely true with even everybody. So which is okay for those, I think about 8 or 10, right? Could you please raise your hands again if you have worked extensively with Unix? About 7, 8 people, which is fine. So those people might find something repetitive. In fact, I would urge those of you who know Unix well to sort of help other guys in the lab, because others who have not used Unix, although the fundamental concepts are same as operating system, but the command structure, the shell scripting, practically everything is so different, it requires some time to get used to it. So without further ado, we will start our discussion. Incidentally, the schedule has been posted to all the senior TAs. Unfortunately, I did not get a printout of the schedule. Maybe I will try to arrange it so that it would be distributed to you, physical printout in the lab. But as of today, 9 to 10 is the lecture, maybe 10, 10:15 or something. 10:30 to 12:30 is the first lab for which a handout has been given to you. Ordinarily, with every lab, there is a submission. And that submission is a single file which you have to upload on an interface called Moodle on a submission link. This will be true for you when you do your labs. This will certainly be true for undergraduate students whom you will be TAs. Unfortunately, the Moodle access and all of these uploading, etc., could happen only when all students have received LDAP logins, and corresponding to those LDAP logins, courses have been created. Now, I presume all of you have done your registration yesterday evening, which means you would have got your LDAP login ID. Unfortunately, there is another interface in the institute which has to create a course in Moodle. Now, today, you would perhaps, if you go to Moodle, did you see Moodle yesterday? Okay, fine. I'll just show the Moodle interface in general. But today, there is no way I can put an assignment which you can automatically download. There is no common interface available. So consequently, the assignment has been given in printed form. If by afternoon we are not able to create a Moodle course called TA Orientation Program, I will mail all of you the assignment, which will be a single file which you can copy onto your machines and sort of untar it and do the assignment in the afternoon. So today's schedule is first lecture, maybe 1 hour, 1.5 hours, then 2 hours lab. Then afternoon 2 to 3 is another lecture, which is on C programming, C, C++ programming. And there will be a corresponding programming lab in the afternoon. I can also tell you what will happen on Monday. Monday again we meet at 9 o'clock. So 9 to, there are I think 2 lectures again, 9 to 10, additional activities in C programming, there will be an assignment. And subsequently we will also ask you to set questions. You will give a C programming test, by the way, on Monday afternoon. So it's a Monday or Tuesday, I do not remember. I'll check the schedule. But as of now, after this, you go to the lab, and the schedule will be available in the lab there. Senior TAs are around here. So the logins, any chance of regular logins, LDAP logins being used by them? We don't know that. CSR means will, they said what, about 10 o'clock or so they will confirm. Fine. So you might want to go there and cross check. Okay. Unix, like any other operating system, is a comprehensive package of utilities and tools. The basic Unix operating system permits you to execute your programs as processors. So each program that executes inside the Unix operating system or under control of Unix operating system is given a process ID. And when your process is loaded, which is loaded by the command that you give, for example, if you say GCC, it is the compiler which has to run. So compiler will get in and that will be given a process ID and so on. If you have compiled a program, you want to load an executable and that executable will be given a process ID. There are a few peculiarities of Unix which you might wish to note. So whenever a process executes inside the Unix environment, a certain set of environment variables are allocated to Unix. So this process runs under as far as your program is concerned which is executing, the environment consists of certain variable values being made available to the process by default and certain files being made available to the process by default. The files which are automatically opened by the operating system for any program that runs are typically called stdin for standard input file, stdout for standard output file, and stderr for a standard error reporting file. So these files you don't have to open, they are automatically opened when your process starts and they are automatically closed by the operating system when your process ends. Ordinarily, by default, these files are connected to the following devices. Since stdin is a standard input, this will be connected to your keyboard. Consequently, whatever you type on the keyboard after the process starts, that stream of bytes will go into your process depending upon what are your input statements and so on. So if it's a C program that you are executing or C++ program, and if you have said C in less A, greater A, greater B, that means you are reading two values for variables A and B, then it will expect this input to come from stdin, which is from the keyboard. Similarly, any cout statement or printf statement in your C program will go on to stdout, which is connected to your monitor. By default, stderr is also connected to your monitor. This is natural, so that when your program executes, the program collects inputs from your keyboard and produces output on the terminal. Unix incidentally does not distinguish between devices, files and directories. For Unix, all of them are files. Unix has a file system which we will briefly describe later. But what I am trying to show you here is the kind of environment that is given to Unix, given to any process which runs under a Unix environment. Environment also consists of a variety of what you may call preset environment variables. an important variable, for example, is called path. So path usually consists of a series of directories like slash user, slash bin, whatever. These directories represent the search path that is used by any process which is running in case it encounters a reference to a file which is expected to be found on the disk file system. So that is the reason why the path must include all possible directories or subdirectories where a required component of your process might be located. So typically if you are using a, you are doing a compilation, then all the libraries etc. which are required for linking need to be present, need to be accessible, and the path will determine that. Path is just one of the many environment variables. If a new environment variable of your choice can be created in Unix by just saying path equal to so and so. But when you want to refer to that particular variable, you prefix a dollar symbol to it. A typical way of showing the value, current value of any environment variable is to say echo. So if you say echo dollar path, this command the Unix operating system in response to this command will actually display this entire string, which is the value of the path variable. Otherwise, the programs run exactly the same way as you run them in any other operating system environment. It has an extensive file system which is managed on the disk. The Unix file system is extendable, that means you can put any number of files, you can create any number of directories, subdirectories, etc., etc. There are some standard directories with some implications which I will show you here. Essentially, the directory and subdirectory structure follows exactly the way that you are familiar with. There is a root which is referred to by slash. Those of you who have worked in Microsoft environment will recall that you use a backslash or the other slash, whereas this is the standard slash that is used in Unix. So any path will, absolute path specification will begin with slash user slash something whatever. Under this, of course, you will have subdirectories, some of which are standard subdirectories which are maintained by the operating system. There could be some user directories which you will yourself be maintaining. So for example, this could be my dir, and under that you could have any subdirectories, any files, whatever. As I said, as far as Unix is concerned, every file is merely a sequence of bytes. A file, you may be able to append to a file, you may be able to delete elements in a file. Files may grow by extension, files may grow by insertion of something in between. Unix file system is fairly flexible. It maintains a free block list. It keeps allocating blocks when you want to extend the file. If you delete something, it will absorb the blocks that you so return, and it generally manages things. It attempts to keep file blocks in a contiguous way, but obviously it can't do so when files undergo changes. So usually there are backend activities which we call system administration activities, which will occasionally compact all free blocks, etc., etc., etc. A standard stuff that you would do on any operating system. Any doubts so far? I think this is simple stuff. Oh, too many. Okay. Fine. So what I just discussed is Unix processes and environment. I will, by the way, upload this entire set of slides on the Moodle. There is a chicken and egg. If there is no Moodle, how will you refer to this? What happened? There is no Nagesh. No, 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 not tomorrow. Tomorrow is too late. They might need it today. So anyway, when you go to the lab, whatever I have described in terms of the commands on Unix, you can actually get them very easily by a command called man, which refers to manual. I will show you how that is to be used. And when you are in the lab, you can refer to those commands. But if you want to make a reference to these slides, I will get them Xeroxed and circulate them to you before your lab ends, so that you can carry them home. Fine. Just remember to tell my staff there. Hello. Okay. The first thing that you do in any operating system is login. As I said, your LDAP accounts have been created, which will permit you to log into the institute, Moodle, etc., etc. But you can't log into the lab systems. Essentially, we are not using the LDAP login for our laboratories, where we have separate servers on which accounts are created for all students. Your accounts will be created in about 1 or 2 working days time. So before your classes start, your accounts would have been created on the institute system. Today, unfortunately, I am not sure whether those accounts would have been created. So they are arranging for some special user IDs, I believe. Yeah. So we have a category of people who support us technically called system administrators. Some of them are regular staff members in the institute. Many of them are students like you, who do that kind of teaching assistantship duty, who become system administrators. They are called sysads. They are like gods. So they hold control over all systems. Ordinary mortals like you and me will have to approach them with folded hands saying, please create my user account, or please give me my login ID, please reset my password, whatever, whatever. In spite of being having the status of gods, they are quite amenable, they are very helpful, and they are the ones who organize things for us. So as I said, your accounts will be created, but today, at least in the first lab, you will possibly be using some dummy accounts. These will be declared by your senior TAs who are helping me conduct this program during the lab session itself. So as I said, we are assuming no background in Linux. We are, of course, for you, assuming reasonably good background in operating system and computing environments, which will not be so for the undergraduate students whom you will be doing TAship for, particularly first year undergraduates. There are several who have never seen a computer in their lives. Last year I had 80 of them. Of course, the class size was 860, so 80 is still 10%, which was surprising because we believed that all students who come to IIT would generally be familiar with computers. There were indeed about 100 or 120 students who had actually done extensive programming in C, C++ during their 11th and 12th standard. So you can see, as teaching assistants, the demands that will be made on you if you ever get associated with the first year BTEC course. On one hand, there will be people who have absolutely no clue about what computing is. On the other hand, there will be people who will probably know better programming than we do. So they will have to be challenged with more difficult problems. They will have to be engaged at a different plane. And yet you cannot forget those who do not know much. You have to sort of train them properly. That's the problem. In a sense, this problem exists even with any batch of any students at any level. So take your own batch. As we saw, about 8 or 10 people have worked extensively on Unix. It's just that their colleges had Unix environment. Now, if Unix is the mainstay, they will appear to have advantage over all of you. But that advantage should be for some time, short-lived. And it should, in my opinion, not extend beyond 1 week. That means within 1 week, you should all become familiar with exactly the same thing. Something similar will happen to undergrad students also. Instead of 1 week, they may take 2 weeks or 3 weeks, for which you people as TAs should be sensitive. So we start with the terminal window where you can type commands. These wordings are meant for first year BTEC students, not for you. You know exactly what windows are and so on. As far as this keyboard, I'm using this keyboard which is not connected anywhere. Sorry? But then it didn't work. हाँ स्पेस बार वर्क्स ओके एरो की डजंट वर्क ओके सो बेसिकली इन यूनिक्स इफ यू वांट टू क्रिएट एनी डायरेक्टरी एट एनी लेवल लेट्स गेट बैक टू दिस स्लाइड हियर इफ यू वांट टू क्रिएट अ डायरेक्टरी अंडर माय डिर हियर देन द कमांड दैट यू गिव इंसिडेंटली the command prompt that you will see will be a dollar symbol so when you log in you will get a dollar symbol which is the command prompt for unix on any terminal although there are graphical windows but generally a whole lot of activities in unix happen through commands that you give and therefore scripting and command interaction is a more natural way of handling unix so that is something that you should become familiar with microsoft environment typically permits a very extensive usage of graphical interfaces so you can say mouse click here do that etc etc the ubuntu environment that you have in the lab will permit you to do so but as natural unix programmers your propensity should be towards going to a command terminal giving commands and doing things because most of the complex things in unix are generally achieved like that as a matter of fact you take any operating system If you want to do simple things, graphical user interface is okay, like copying a file from one directory to another, etc. But if you want to do something fairly complex, where you have to resort to writing scripts in the command language of that operating system, you have no choice but to go to a terminal and do the same thing, whether it is Microsoft, whether it is Unix or IBM AIX or whatever. So essentially. Making a directory means you give this command make dir followed by a name to create a directory. Ordinarily, you would go to your home directory when you log in. If you want to change directory to a subdirectory so that the commands are executed within the context of that subdirectory, you have to use a command cd. Cd stands for change directory. These are some of the essential Unix commands that you should be familiar with. ls is a command which generally lists all files present in the working directory. Working directory is current directory at which you are. PWD displays the present directory. CD changes directory. CD dot dot goes to the next higher level in the hierarchy tree. So it is backup one directory level. RM is to remove a file, a very powerful command, and there is an option called hyphen r or minus r. Minus r stands for recursively remove files. So if by chance you are in the home directory and if you say rm minus r, you can say end of the day go home because there will be absolutely nothing left in the directory. So rm command should be used with great caution. In general, a good practice is even before you type rm, you must first type pwd to see where you are so you know that you are in an appropriate subdirectory which you wanted to delete otherwise this mistake is very very common in the early days you should be careful about it cp copies a file mv moves or renames a file so the equivalent of a rename command in microsoft environment would be mv that is move so the file is not physically moved actually it would in fact be moved if the file has to go from one physical disk volume to another physical disk volume but within the same directory structure in any other subdirectory if you say move it is like renaming and relocating the indexes which point to that file as you all know files physically may exist anywhere but the access to that file is through some pointers which are maintained by the operating system and that file system says this is the pointer so presently this pointer is here If you say move, the pointer will be shifted to that point. Okay, so the new name will be inserted in the directory structure for the name that you have given to the file, but that new name will point to still to the same physical file. Mkdir, as you just saw, is to make a directory. Rmdir is to remove a directory. In general, you can group Linux basic commands into general purpose utilities. Commands which relate to the file system, and there are file handling commands, compressing and archiving files. You are all familiar with zip, so you have a collection of files, directories, subdirectories, etc. You want to put them into a single container. Okay. So how to get a container like that? So you select a list of files or directories and you say zip them. The equivalent of zip is tar. Tar stands for tape archive. We shall see how that command is used for tarring and untarring. The equivalent of zipping and unzipping. And then of course some simple filters. This is what we are going to discuss. So these are some general purpose utilities. Cal, which gives you a calendar. So if you say Cal January 2009, you will get a January 2009 calendar. Cal August 2010 will give you August 2010 calendar, a useful utility. Date is a utility which will print the date. You can actually print the date in the format where you print date, hour, minute, second, so current time, etc. is printed. It's fairly simple stuff. I told you about echo. Echo actually is a command which echoes to std out, which means onto your monitor, anything that you say after echo. So it's like, you know the English word echo, right? You go to mountainous region and you shout, the mountains will return back the shout to you. You call it an echo. So it's exactly that. You say echo this and the monitor echoes it back to you. So if you want to just echo a message onto the terminal, you put this message. Why would you type echo message and then see the message? Because you are seeing it when you are typing it also. Any idea why would such a thing be necessary? Echo message. See, common sense, yeah.
When you need to find the health of certain environmental variables with the dollar sign, or when you are scripting using the...
Yeah, well, that we shall see later. So when you are talking about printing out values of environment variables, and that's a correct answer. So as I said, I want to know what is the current path. Then I say echo dollar path. So when I type echo dollar path, I don't know what is the value of the path. In fact, echo will find out that value and print it, which is okay. The question I am asking is, why would I ever say echo message? Saying echo hello world, it will actually show hello world. But hello world is what I am typing anyway. So why would I do that? Echo hi, echo hello world, why would I do that? Because what I am typing only, I am going to get out.
We'll give a condition. If it's true, we'll require a message. If it's false, we'll require another message.
Okay. Sorry? Okay. So let me expand on that. This explanation is absolutely correct. Ordinarily, looked at echo as a single command which somebody is typing and getting result makes sense only if I am echoing values of environment variable or something like that. But echo followed by a string would not make sense ordinarily if I want to execute as a single command. But what happens is, each of these single commands that I have listed could be collected together and can be issued as a sequence of commands, exactly like your instructions in a C program. Your C program or C++ programs are compiled and then executed. A set of commands that are given to Unix like this is called a shell script, which is essentially a program written in shell programming language. Now, if you write a program like this, within which you might do some testing whether this process is running still or not, or if that process is dead, or if that file exists or not, then using the if-then-else control structures which Unix shell provides, you might want to say, if that is so, then show me error message, file does not exist. Otherwise, show me an error message, I am proceeding further. So there will be an if-then-else statement within which you will use echo this string or echo that string. And that is where echo with a specific string does make sense, right? So you should in fact become familiar with shell programming very, very thoroughly, because that is what you will be using for the next 2 years here. You can also use printf. You are all familiar with C++, so printf is okay. There is a calculator. So it's a text-based calculator. So you enter an input like this, it produces output. Control D is essentially an end of file symbol. You know that all files have an EOF associated. In your programs, when you open a file, you read the file till end of file. So ordinarily this files, whenever the file lands, the operating systems will send you a special signal called UF. When STD in is connected to your keyboard, the Unix operating system will perpetually be looking at the keyboard for input. How do you signal end of file? You signal it by saying Control D. So whenever you press Control D, it signifies end of file on STD in. Xcalc is a graphic based calculator. I use the word shell scripting to contrast it with the conventional programming languages where programs are pre-compiled. Scripts are not pre-compiled. However, script is also a specific command in Unix. So if you script demo, well, demo is, let's say, an executable file, say script started, file is demo, etc., etc. So script done on Saturday, 26 September, so and so. So basically, whatever commands you give, the script is capable of putting a tag at the beginning and tag at the end. Password, changing password. Notice the syntax, it is not password, it is passwd. So when you say password, it means of course your own password. If you say password username, it means that user's password. Of course, you can't arbitrarily go around changing anybody's password. So unless you have the authority to do so, generally such authority to do anything with any user rests with what we call the super user in Unix or the root user. And none of you on the machines that you will be using in this lab would have super user access. You remember the category of gods that I mentioned? Sysadmins. Yes. So sysads hold all the root passwords. If you make friends with them, you might occasionally get that privilege. Who is a command which tells you who are all currently logged in? Incidentally, this is how you would see this dollar symbol is the symbol that the operating system gives you, as I told you, where you write all your commands. However, before the dollar symbol, you will see generally a host of characters. So these will typically identify your home directory or the user in the home directory and so on, telling you where you are currently. So that's an additional input that you can get. If you give a who command, it will tell you, for example, who are the users who are currently running. So for example, there may be a guest user who is running on the terminal PTS2, and Mansi, who is herself trying to investigate who is running, finds out that she is actually logged in three times from these three terminals, which is perfectly fine with Unix. It shows the user, the device file, date, time, and logged in from where. So it's a very, very useful command. There is one of the assignments of the task that I have given you is to write a shell script which will collect all the user data, sort it, print it, etc., etc. This is a small thing. So W gives you more details about the users. Otherwise, exactly the same thing as who. Man is probably the most important command, certainly in the initial days of your interaction with Unix, but throughout your life of interaction with Unix. Even today I use it extensively because Unix is so rich that it is impossible to remember the syntax and semantics of every command and every option. In fact, that is true for any complex field, right? Take any operating system, you can't remember it. So man was introduced in Unix in the very early days. Man stands for manual pages display. Every Unix operating system, right from day one, from 70s, it always comes bundled with manual pages. And if you give a man command followed by any command name, then the manual pages for that command are displayed to you. So if you say man ls, for example, okay, so ls is list directory contents. Name of the command is ls, synopsis, ls option file. So this is just a sample, but you should actually spend most of your time today in looking at various man options, because that is the best way of assimilating what all features are available. And there are extensive features, there are extensive options for every command. This is just the format in which the man command prints the manual page or displays the manual page. The manual page is displayed one full screen. You can go to the next page using page down or space. And if you are done with any manual observation, you just type Q, which is for quit, you will get out. The Linux file system internals is a fairly involved topic and out of scope for discussion here. But you would generally be familiar with file systems of various operating systems, right? So you know exactly how file systems are organized. Unix file system is based on the concept of inodes, which exist in a separate area. There is an inode or information node for every file, which means a directory or a device file or whatever. And then, as I said, a file is extendable, so it is allocated blocks as it is required and deallocated blocks when it is not required. What I am going to describe here is the more mundane part of the file system, which is information about how files are organized typically in Linux. So slash or the root, it stands for the topmost root level node. Under that, these are some of the standard names. So slash home is the home directory for all users. Slash root is the home directory of privileged user. Slash dev is all devices which are accessible as files. So terminal, keyboard, mouse, whatever you have, all external devices, printers. As I said, Unix treats all of them as devices. They are called special files. Okay. Slash MNT used to mount other directories or partitions. So typically you take a pen drive like this and you insert it in a USB port. The pen drive contains its own operating system, its own file system. Now you are pushing this and this has to be made part of the root file system. So in the root there will be some directory, subdirectory, something at which point you might want to connect the root of this file system. So unlike in the Microsoft OS where a new device always goes at the top level along with all other devices. In Unix, it is not necessarily so. You can mount a device at any mount point. I'm so sorry, I forgot to switch this off. So as I said, you can connect it to any particular point in that tree. So suppose particular point where you want to connect this is, let's say, my device is slash user slash fatec slash something slash my device. Now my device does not contain any other subdirectories or something, but I want to treat that as a mounting point where I will mount this. So the slash MNT actually lists all the mount points of other directories and partitions. So slash var stands for variable data. Typical examples are mail files, log files, etc. Slash USR, USR stands for user. Unfortunately, it's a misnomer. Slash USR typically does not contain the subdirectories or actual users of the operating system. It typically contains all the packages which have been installed. So the packages could be a C compiler, a graphic library package, any other utility package. Whatever you have, all those packages will be installed under slash user directory. Under slash user USR, there are several other directories. So lib, doc, etc., src. Slash etc is really an etc thing, which contains all configuration files. It is worthwhile for you to explore. Just go to slash etc and say ls. Just see what files are there. Because familiarity is not necessarily by reading exact syntax and executing the commands alone. You'll have to do that for some of the commands which you'll have to use extensively. But in general, it's a good idea to be extremely curious about what is where, what is what. Because even if you see a glimpse of something, somewhere in your mind, the human mind will automatically record it somewhere. And then later on when you have to use it, you will be able to connect it more rapidly. I have found it very advantageous. You might also want to do that. So these are some of the file system commands. Cat is a command. Cat actually stands for concatenate. So it is used to concatenate or join together two files. But if you give only one file name, it will only display. The activity is like that. If you concatenate file 1 and file 2, he is supposed to take file 1, take file 2, concatenate them and throw the output of STD out. So STD out is the target of concatenation always. So if you don't give two file names but only one file name, it will take that file and just put it onto STD out. Effectively it becomes show me that file. So you say cat file name. Okay. But the objective of the cat is concatenation. So cat sample file dot text will actually display the contents of this file. CP, as I already told you, MV, sample dot text, mode dot text. So this will be renamed. Mkdir is to make a directory. RM, mode dot text, it will delete this file. RMdir, dir1, it will remove that directory. RM minus R, directory name, will recursively delete all files, as I told you. I'll make these things available, but as I said, any time you have a problem, you just go to man, see that thing, and just try and execute this. As I said, RM minus R is the only dangerous command. But otherwise, if you give any command, you make a mistake in syntax. Okay. One great advantage of working with computers is that computers are incapable of shouting back at us. So even if we make some mistakes, at most it will say, I don't understand it. That's right. So you again type something. So there's absolutely no issue. And by the way, this is something I have noticed generally amongst our student population in the country. We are mortally afraid of making mistakes. And the only thing we are more afraid of is somebody catching our mistake. But let me tell you one great thing about this environment that I learned is that making mistakes is perfectly okay. In fact, only by making mistakes I will learn more. The only thing that I should try and achieve is not to repeat the same mistake again. So learning is greatly advantaged if you make mistakes actually. So don't hesitate. You don't have to purposely make mistakes. It doesn't add to any learning. But if you accidentally make a mistake, you should be absolutely, absolutely not worried about. Making mistakes is okay. Okay, as long as you learn from it. So don't be hesitant. Should I type this command? So let me first look at man. Don't do that. If you have some hunch, type it. As I said, the machine doesn't shout back at you. It will give an error. Then maybe think about it, then look at the man page. Believe me, the learning that will happen through this will be stronger. Each file has attributes. So typically a file is traditionally considered to belong to three sets of people. One is the original user himself or herself. Suppose I have created a file, the file belongs to me. So I am called the owner. I might be working with a group of people who might want to access that file, edit that file, modify that file. So there is a group of users associated with that file. So consequently, the group will have some access rights to that file. And finally, the general public, anybody wants to see that file, for example. So the public has some rights. So user, group and public are the three categories of users associated with the file. The file access permissions are of three types: read, write and execute. So these are called read permission, write permission, execute permission. If I am a creator of the file, I automatically have read, write and execute permissions. In fact, execute permission means the file must be an executable so that I can execute it as a command. Usually, the files that we deal with will not be executable files. So these will be read, write files or read, write and executable files occasionally. To my group, I definitely want to give read privileges, may not want to give write privileges. It is not uncommon when you are working on a group project for files to have read and write permissions for both the user who created, that is the owner, and the group. Public typically has read access. However, you can control this access yourself. So you can actually define for every file individually what would be the access permissions for anyone, including yourself. So for example, group of three characters, each one for owner, one for group, one for other. So R, W and X are the read, write, execute permissions. And these are represented by actually binary numbers. So 3-bit binary number, what is the largest value? 7. Okay. And the smallest value is of course 0. depending upon where that bit is, one bit represents read, one bit represents write, one bit represents execute. So if that bit is on, that permission is available. That bit is off, zero, permission is not available. You can now see all possible combinations. Okay. So you can actually describe by a number the permissions that you want to give to each individual user group and the public, but you can also use the keywords, key letters R, W and X. If you say list minus L, that means list giving more information, a file which is shown here prog.c, it will show you some other details of that file, but more importantly it will give you all the file permissions. So R W dash R dash dash R dash dash. Invariably you will find these are the default permissions associated with any file that you create. Yeah.
So what is the first hyphen used for?
No, that hyphen is the fellow who prepared this slide.
Before the RW.
This hyphen is what my fellow wrote as a hyphen. There is no hyphen there.
No, in the previous slide I saw it, it's a D written there.
Directory.
No, that's a if directory kind of thing. Okay. Just go and play around, you'll find out. But there is no hyphen there. This hyphen is inserted by my colleague who prepared this transparency.
Okay.
This is not Unix work. This is that fellow's work. Okay. So, oh, wait a sec. Is there a hyphen at the beginning? Where there seems to be a hyphen everywhere. I doubt very much. Oh, whether it's a directory or a file. Ah, sorry. See, I'm really getting old. Thanks. So, he was right and you were right to suspect something. That D that was written there. So, if there is a dash, that means it's an ordinary file. If there is a D, that means it's a directory file. Under which there could be. So, when you say CD, you can say CD to any one of these entries which has a D here, which means that's a directory. I'm terribly sorry, goofed up. Okay. But what is important here is from the permission point of view is read, write and no execute, read, no write, no execute, read, no write, no execute. So these are the three permissions allocated to people. You can change these permissions by using a command called change mode, which is called CHMOD. Unfortunately, Unix, the original authors, I mean the whole group of Cunningham, Ritchie and all other fellows, Thompson, who wrote Unix operating system in 1972 in Bell Labs, okay, they did not want to type long things, I suppose. So they designed compact commands. Abbreviation in general is a forte of all computer science people. So chmod is the command given. Now if you want to change the mode for prog.c, you can say 775. So 7, as you can see, is 111. That means all read, write, execute permission. This next 7 also says the same thing for the group. But 5 is 101. So you can see appropriately read, write, execute, read, write, execute, read, no write, but execute. So these permissions are given. You can set these permissions. You can also set the default permissions for yourself. So any file that you create, the default would be something like this. Cat, as I told you, concatenate files and the output goes to std out. Tac concatenates them in reverse. So the last line of the file will come first, first line of the file will come last. More or less are paging output. If you say cat, as I told you, cat will display the file on std out, which means you can see it on the screen. But the file is a 1000 line file, the file will whiz past so quickly that you will see only the last screen full. You would like to sort of scroll things and so on without having to go to an editor. So for that the commands are more or less. So more actually means show more of the file and less means show less of the file. Both are exactly equivalent. Actually there are options there which can show the initial part or the later part of the file. But in general, less file name has become a very standard usage. Ah, control A, right? Yes, now I got my pointer. It was disappearing. So less file name has become a very standard way of displaying any text file onto the screen. Okay. You can also say cat file name greater than less, but I will discuss that when I show you the redirection. So it will exactly like the manual page. Whenever you want to go to the next page, you press space, you go to the next page. WC gives you a word count, so statistics of the file. So count the number of lines, words and characters. WC sample.txt, it will give you so many lines, so many words, so many characters. WC minus L, WC minus W, WC minus C will give you individual counts if you want. WC will give you total count. This is something that I would like you to be very conscious about. I have seen many people not being able to do that. All of you have compiled C programs, okay? C++ programs, whatever environment, Microsoft or whatever. If I asked you what was the size of the largest executable file you ever created and what was the size of the smallest executable file you ever created, can you tell me offhand? In general, how many of you ever see the size of the executable at all? Generally, never. In general, how many times you always see the total number of lines of code that you have written in the source program itself? Sometimes. You would all have done your final year project. Most of you would have written some programs for that project. It would be a programming system, several functions, several things. Okay. But if somebody asked you how many lines of code has your group written, your answer typically will be about 500, about 1000, about 5000. None of you would be ever able to say 4,253 lines of code. Do you agree? I think that's a very bad professional practice. It is important for you to be aware of the sizes. Let me take 2 minutes off and tell you why it is important. Two reasons. One is, in general, as a thumb rule, the larger size of source code represents larger effort and more complexity. It's a thumb rule. It need not always be true. I mean, I can always write 50 lines of actual code and 500 lines of comment and say 550 lines. Okay. But including comments and all, generally the larger the file. So what is the largest programming system that you would have dealt with typically in your undergraduate days? Any numbers? No exact numbers, I'm just asking for like thumb rule. 1500. Okay. These are called trivial programming systems. Okay. Even simple programming system would have 5000 to 10000 lines of code. Okay. The programming system that our aeronautical development agency lab has developed, which is working on a simulator builder for last 20 years, the current code is roughly 150000 lines. You take a banking application, the lines of code, and I'm not talking of translated code, source code, would be about 1 million lines or 2 million lines. So you have to worry about the lines of code. You should be familiar with this concept and you should generally count lines of code. So in short, I would like you to do WC on everything that you do. Why is the executable size important? Let's go back to the days when the computers had memory measurable in 64 kilobytes. Have you ever heard of those days? 64 kilobytes is the main memory of a large computer. Okay. If your compiled program got compiled and was of the size 120 kilobytes, the program cannot run. Today, even the most ordinary PC that you sit with, the desktop you sit with, would typically have 512 megabytes of memory, if not 1 gigabyte or 2 gigabytes. Consequently, the executable file sizes are very low as compared to the physical memory, and consequently we have stopped completely bothering about those. But consider a C program which is written to go into an embedded system, let's say inside a dishwasher or inside a television. You're familiar with embedded systems? Embedded systems are systems which are actually microcontrollers or whatever. And they do specific tasks like sensing something, switching on something, whatever. It is not uncommon that these people have a read-only memory where you store the final code of the size of 32 kilobytes, 64 kilobytes. If you as professional programmers have never been conscious of the size of the executable, then you will be extremely bad embedded system programmers. It is not that you can't write code, but it is that because you are not aware, you are not conscious of doing something with your program such that the resultant code size is compact, and therefore it will be very hard for you to write a correct program which will fit into that space. You are all familiar with time complexity of algorithm, and you do bother about it. So if a time complexity is order n square, you try to make it n log n, order log n, whatever, whatever. But in general, the space complexity has been given a go-by by all professionals. So just as execution time measured by clock is a small representative of time complexity of the underlying algorithm, similarly, the executable file size is in some way representative of the space complexity. And I would like you to be aware of that. Sorry for digression, but I believe these are important things. Okay, we've seen that. CMP compares two files. this file comparison is done byte by byte. So you have one sample.txt and sample copy.txt. You don't know if somebody has edited the copy. You want to see whether these files are same. If they are not, what is the difference? So CMP will compare that. And it will say differ by 2 line 1, and it prints location of the first mismatch. There are additional commands that are extremely useful. COM gives you what is common. So the first column will give you words only from first file, second column will give you words only from second file, and third column will give you words common to both files. Where would this COM be used? Have you heard of version control systems? Okay, when you are developing large software, typically in groups but even individually, you will come up with, let's say, one program which you want to make some changes to. That program is working, but you want to modify something. The moment you editate and modify, somehow it stops working. Now you want to go back to the original place and you have forgotten what changes you have made. In general, how we handle that situation in an ordinary fashion? Well, I'll call it program1.c. And then when I edit it, I save it as program2.c. So in about 20 days time, I have program17.c. And now I don't even know which program was doing what. Okay. So how did these programs differ from each other is extremely difficult for me to keep track of. A version control system permits you to maintain versions of the program automatically. It will give you the latest version anytime that you want, but it is also capable of giving you any version. Of course, if it were to maintain different versions as individual files, a lot of disk space will be wasted. So what it does, unlike you and me, who will say program1.c, program2.c, program3.c, it will start with the root program, it will save it as whatever the base version. Whenever you edit and you want to tell the version control system, save this as next version 2, it will not save that entire file. It will find the difference between this file and the original file, and it will save only the difference. In fact, it saves the difference in the form of editing commands such that when those editing commands are applied to the base file, the new version is created. These are some of the utilities which permit you to find the differences. I'm explaining this to you because eventually, or rather earlier rather than later, you should learn to use a version control system for any work that you do for any course or any lab. It's extremely useful. CVS is what we use mostly here, right? CVS is loaded onto our machines. Concurrent version system, no. So which version control people used? CVS only. Finally, archiving and extracting using tar is generally used for backup. I told you it's like zip. So TAR actually stands for tape archive. It's a very old nomenclature. Nobody uses tape these days. So usually you can write a TAR file onto a tape. many operational agencies, operational organizations actually use this for tape archiving, the tar command. But an output file that can be created, which typically has an extension .tar.gz. You know what gz is? No zip. Okay, so gz is an extension, and you can give either a file or a directory. These are various options. C will mean create an archive, X means extract files from archive, F is name of archive. So, unlike zip and unzip, you don't have tar and untar. The command is tar. You can use it to create a tar, or you can use it to untar also. So, minus X will mean extract, C will mean create. Z is to make file.tar.gz. So, this is Z option. Test the tar that you use GNU zip. So tar.gz, by the way, is a general format which can be unzipped or untarred by even Microsoft environment or any environment. So here are some commands. Basically, there is a lab exercise. You can actually experiment with that. So this is for creating an archive. This is for extracting from the archive. This is just to view contents of an archive without extracting. You just want to see what is there in the archive. Then these are simple filters, head and tail. So head displays the top of the file, default is 10 lines, tail displays the last 10 lines. You can give option minus n, so it will display those many lines. You would typically use this if you have large number of data files, and you don't remember what that name represents, or if you have names with dates and all, you want to just see what is there, you can use head or tail. This is an interesting command. It assumes that you have a text file where data is put in multiple columns. You will get these kind of things typically as a saved version of a spreadsheet file, for example, which has columns, or you could also create them yourself. But this can actually cut columns. So for example, if you say minus C 1, 2, 3, 4 data.txt, you might get, it also depends upon what you have in the file. I think when this slide was prepared, there was some data file there. So you can actually see in the context of that data file only. But you can define a delimiter. For example, the columns in the file may be delimited by space, may be delimited by tab, may be delimited by comma. Comma is usually most often used because all of you are familiar with spreadsheets, either Microsoft Excel or any other spreadsheet. Okay, so you can always export data from a spreadsheet in a popular format called CSV or comma separated values. So if the spreadsheet has 5 columns, each row will contain 5 values, a value separated by comma. The comma separated value CSV type of format file is very often used as input file for a variety of processing. Okay. I'll show you an example in one of the subsequent lectures here, where I'll introduce a utility called awk. Okay. So how do you handle the comma separated file? So these utilities like cut will give you this. Of course, the output here does not make sense unless you see the actual data file. As a matter of fact, it will be interesting that whenever I give you the printout of these slides, look at the output of cut and create an input file which will create this output. So that will be an interesting exercise. Sort is a regular sort command. It's part of the Unix operating system. So when you say, it will sort by ASCII characters first, then numerals, and then uppercase and then lowercase. So usage is just sort by file name, but you can also define the column number, you can also define a delimiter. So you can actually sort comma delimited data also with this. Paste the content of the file side by side. So it's very, very interesting. So basically it is not concatenation of files one after another, but concatenation lines of the file. Grep is a very powerful command. It will search a string or a pattern in a file. the pattern is prescribed as a regular expression. All of you are familiar with the regular expression? Not very enthusiastic, yes. Yes, sir. Okay. Because that's a term which you would have done somewhere in or the other in your computer science or IT course, right? Even for GATE you would have studied regular expressions, fine. So you can specify a regular expression and the grep can search that in the file effectively. Okay. So if this is the file 3.txt, it has three lines. Grep session file 3.txt. Today is Linux command session. You basically print out a line which contains that regular expression. About scripts now. Now not the script command, but scripts, as somebody correctly pointed out. We would like to execute a whole set of commands written as a single program. That program is called shell script. It is not uncommon to give an extension .sh to such a file. So myprog.sh will not be a C program or a C++ or Java program, but it would be a set of shell commands given to do some meaningful activity. I have tried to give some small exercise where you could write two or three shell commands like this in a file and then execute that file. There are some more commands here. DU will tell you about the disk space usage. PS will give you the snapshot of the current process. Remember, I told you that process is the basic unit which executes in a Unix environment. And when your program is executed, it also executes a process. Each process has a number, and each process will have additional information about, like how much CPU time it has taken, how much this, whatever. So once you identify a process number, there are other utilities which will tell you more about that process. Okay. So PS is essentially a command which will give you a snapshot of the current process. If you say minus U, all processes run by that user will be given. If you say PS minus EF, it will list all processes that are working there. These are add user and delete user commands. Again, ordinary mortals like you and me will not be able to do that unless we own the computer. But the semi-gods, our friend sysapps, would be doing this routinely. DF will tell you the disk usage of the file system. So various devices which are mounted at various mount points in the file system, it will generally tell you size, used amount, available amount, used percentage, and where it is mounted. Minus H is actually a human readable format. Otherwise, you can have in terms of blocks and so on, whatever. It's a useful idea to occasionally keep saying df minus h, and if you see any percentage here shooting beyond 70 or 80, you should be worried about your disk space. It's like exactly like properties that you see in a Microsoft environment for any drive, okay, or any directory for that matter. FDisk is for creation and manipulation of partition tables. We will not go into the details of this. You can look at the man thing. But FDisk minus L is useful. It will list the partition tables. Incidentally, you can't actually execute FDisk command to create and manipulate partition tables because that is a privileged access. The network configuration of your machine can be quickly looked at by using the ifconfig command. So it will, for example, tell you which are the links, which are the addresses, broadcast addresses, INET addresses, MAS, etc. All of you are familiar with networks, right? So you can see these are the details about the network that you can find out. Okay. So to conclude, what I have attempted here is to give you an overview of Unix operating system, how the commands work, and some of the important and useful commands. The assignment that you have is essentially an indicator. So it is not like a lab assignment that you are familiar with where you have to submit something. You are now all postgraduate students, so one expects that you will work responsibly to maximize your learning. That is what is expected from the first lab. The second lab, you actually have to make a submission. That I will announce during the lecture from 2 to 3, where you will be doing some C programming. Since the Moodle might not have been created by that time, I will give you an email ID where you have to send a mail containing exactly one tar file. So that will be your assignment submission. And that tar file may contain a variety of other things. The assignment itself will be shipped to you, if there is no Moodle in the afternoon, will be shipped to your email ID as exactly one tar file. So you take that tar file, untar that using the tar command in a directory, work on those C programs and modify whatever. That's the way we'll operate. Is that all right? Any quick questions? Because you'll require at least 10 minutes to port yourself from point A to point B. You are all familiar with the old software lab? That's where you went yesterday? There are two software labs. Okay. So OSL is where you'll go now. Any questions, observations? I have one observation. I came 3 minutes late, nobody shouted at me. Four. Five, I see. Achha, which watch? We use this watch. Okay. By the time I was at that door, I think it was 3 or 3.5 minutes. By the time I reached here, it was 4. And by the time I started, it was more than 5, in fact. Sorry for that. It will not happen again. Okay. Bye. So, enjoy lab.